Hello and welcome to another episode of Jewish History Lab. Today we're going to begin discussing the Holocaust, one of the most difficult chapters in the long history of the Jewish people. Please note that this information is intended for educational content only. I will only be speaking very briefly about the Holocaust within the context of this series, but if you are curious and are motivated to learn more, I have an entire online course which is specifically on the topic of the Holocaust, and it is free and open to the community. Please see the lecture notes for a link to that particular course. What I'd like to do today is to speak a little bit about the interwar period and the Jews. But let us begin first with a discussion of the terminology. What is this word Holocaust? Where does it come from and why do we use that term? So the Holocaust itself, obviously we're speaking about the Nazi attempt to destroy the Jews of Europe during World War II. It was such a huge and audacious act of brutality that it begged a specific term to try to capture what it referred to. In the 1940s through the 1970s, various terms were tossed about to try and capture the sense of this historical event. Probably the first term that was used is the word genocide, which was coined by this man, Raphael Lemkin, in 1944. And the term comes from the words genos, meaning people, or class in the sense of a class of family, and cide, meaning to kill, like as in homicide or suicide or patricide, that kind of thing. So genocide means the killing of a people. And that term was very useful and of course has entered the English language, but it lacks a specific Jewish context. It doesn't specifically address the fact that the Nazis really targeted the Jews. There were other people such as the Roma and Sinti and others, but the Jews really were high on the list of targeted populations, and so genocide is a little bit too generic. A term that began to be used in the 1960s is Holocaust. Here's a poster from a film that popularized the Holocaust, starring Meryl Streep and others. And where does this term come from? So actually, it's kind of a problematic term. It is a word taken from the Latin translation of the Hebrew Bible. The translation is called the Vulgate. And in Leviticus chapter 29, by the way, it's a different numbering system as well than the Hebrew Bible, the verse in Leviticus uses the term Holocaust as a translation for the Hebrew term Ola, which means a sacrifice that is completely burned up. And in the verse in Leviticus, it talks about offering a Holocaust with a pleasing odor to God. Now, the term definitely has some value to it. It definitely has a sense of everything being burned up, even though, you know, the majority of the victims in the Holocaust were not actually burned to death. They were gassed to death or shot and others, but still it does have some kind of totality to it. But at the same time, it has theological problems. Like, are we actually going to say that if the Jews are serving as the sacrificial lamb, so to speak, what does that make the Nazis? And how do we say that connects to God perceiving a pleasing odor? I mean, these are very problematic terms. So for that reason, many religious thinkers prefer not to use the term Holocaust, and they rely on the Hebrew term churban, which means destruction. And that term churban is specifically connected to the destruction of the temples in Jerusalem in 586 before the Common Era and in the year 70 of the Common Era. So for religious thinkers, the term Churban is definitely popular, but it also adds a kind of a religious coloration that is problematic for more secular users. In Israel, the most popular term is undoubtedly Shoah, also a Hebrew term that occurs in the Bible, but it does not have that same connotation of connecting it to the destruction of the temples and the, you know, theological baggage that goes along with it. One last term. We should be careful because some of the terms that are used, I personally think, are rather offensive. For example, to use the term extermination, the extermination of the Jews of Europe. You know, extermination is a term we use for vermin, which plays right into the Nazi ethic with regards to their destruction of this population of people. And there are certain terms like final solution and Lösung, which were actually coined by Nazis themselves. Here you see a mugshot of Hermann Göring from the Nuremberg trials, and he used terms like this, and end seal, the end goal, things like that. So Holocaust is a difficult term to use. It has some problems with it, but nevertheless, it is the term that has become most popular in the English language, and so therefore we will use it for expediency. So when we go to the historical data here, the Jews in Europe at this time, you can see this map, which comes from the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum. They're spread out across Europe. The great mass of them are in Eastern Europe, in the Soviet Union and in Poland in particular. Germany has only about 500,000 Jews. They tend to be highly assimilated. They tend to speak German very well, dress like Germans, tend to have less outward adherence to traditional Jewish observance, whereas when you move to the east, you have a lot more of the masses of traditional Hasidic and Lithuanian Jews who are much more obviously Jewish from without. But that didn't stop anti-Semitism from spreading in Germany in particular. In fact, a lot of the anti-Semitism the Nazis relied on had a specific coloration. We've spoken in previous lectures about the development of anti-Semitism through several phases, from ancient xenophobia to medieval Jew hatred. And when you get to the modern period, there is a very kind of quasi-scientific quality to it, in which the Nazis have largely abandoned the outwardly religious aspect of previous forms of anti-Semitism, and they focus on this racial quality connected with the idea of a conspiracy, specifically that the Jews constitute a distinct kind of race that are altogether joined in a global conspiracy to dominate other races. And the way in which they dominate, which obviously is very difficult because the Jews are a tiny minority of the population, is specifically in some kind of cancerous or bacteriological form. Like, for example, here you see a German language novel from 1920 that shows a hideous kind of vulture that's weighing down this shirtless man. And what this picture is meant to say is that the Jews, who are like carrion eaters, they're vermin, they live off decay, they're going to dominate the otherwise healthy, strong, muscular Aryan races. And once they eat them out like a cancer from within, then they will feed on their corpses. The title, by the way, reads Die Sünde wider das Blut, ein Zeitroman, The Sin Against the Blood, a Novel of the Times. And the fact that the Jews of Germany, which were much more assimilated, actually fed into a lot of this, such as, for example, and you see this really bizarre form of children's propaganda published in the 1930s by Elvira Bauer, a really twisted kindergarten teacher who became propagandist. This is a book for children called Der Giftpilz, The Poison Toadstool, right? And the thing about toadstools is that they look like mushrooms, but unless you are very careful and you know the signs, you will always mistake them for healthy mushrooms. And you might eat one of these, but it's actually poison. So too, the metaphor goes that the Jews look like regular Germans, but in reality, they are quite distinct, racially different, and they represent a threat. And that's the kind of theme that goes on in that particular piece of propaganda. The Nazis frequently referred to Jews as various kinds of vermin who are bent on destroying the entire world through a global conspiracy, like this French language piece of Nazi propaganda that shows the Jew as some kind of like vicious tarantula straddling the globe, or here something from the Warsaw Ghetto that shows that the Jews carry typhus, that they're associated with this deadly lice-borne disease, and so on. So, and here finally, here's an Austrian example. This is just terrifying. Again, from the elections of that early interwar period, the Jew is portrayed as some kind of like devilish snake who is strangling the Austrian eagle. And the image reads in German, Deutsche Christen rettet Österreich, which means German Christians save Austria. right? Meaning you have to vote for a particular political party in order to save Austria from this Jewish snake, who, by the way, is associated with the communists, because you can see the hammer and sickle are lying underneath there. So that's the kind of, you know, atmosphere that Hitler came of age in. Now, here's an image of Hitler as a baby, kind of a chilling image to look at. Hitler had a difficult relationship with his father, who was much older than his mother. When his father passed away at 18, that allowed Hitler himself a little bit more freedom, because he had always wanted to be an artist. He had some middling talent. Here you can see some of his artwork that's actually, you know, available on the web. Unfortunately for the young Adolf, he was not especially talented, and he was rejected from the Vienna School of Art, a rejection that stung him bitterly, and in fact he complained about it in his memoirs later. And he always felt that somehow his rightful place in the Vienna School of Art was taken by a Jewish applicant, and this idea of the replacement theory, meaning that Hitler felt he should have been in the Vienna School of Art, but a Jew had replaced him. A Jew had, you know, supplanted his rightful place in the incoming student body. That's something that, by the way, reverberates throughout a lot of nationalist, white supremacist thought, right up into America in the early 21st century. At any rate, he found new purpose with the onset of World War I, and he enjoyed it enthusiastically. He was actually wounded during World War I. He was the victim of a gas attack, which gas was used at that time, as we discussed in a previous lecture. But when Germany surrendered in November 1918, he, like many other Germans, felt that this was a stab in the back that was somehow orchestrated by Jews. Here you can see another Austrian propaganda cartoon that captures the idea of the stab in the back, which in German was the Dolchstoss. You can see the and by the way, I'm using some Austrian materials here. We should mention that Hitler himself was actually an Austrian, and Austria and Germany, although they are separate countries, they are really in one larger cultural unit. Austria would join with Germany in the Anschluss, they would prosecute the war together, but that's for later on. At any rate, here is an Austrian depiction of the anger that many Austrians felt over the surrender in World War I. There's the lantern-jawed Austrian soldier with a steely gaze, you know, defending the Western Front, and sneaking up behind him is this hideous-looking woman that has a Jewish star on the French style hat that she is wearing, and with this leering smile she's stabbing him in the back, meaning that the Jews somehow betrayed Germany and Austria from within, causing a lot of anti-war sentiment and causing the Germans to surrender prematurely before they could have actually won in World War I. Hitler, when he came back from the war, got very much involved in right-wing politics. He participated in the Beer Hall Putsch, in which there was actually an attempted insurrection, for which he was arrested and sent to jail. Here is a picture of him, believe it or not, in jail. He actually had a very cushy time there. The judge who sentenced him was clearly very sympathetic to Hitler's aims, and although he could not let him off scot-free, he gave him a very, very light sentence in jail, very brief duration, and allowed him a personal chef, all kinds of ridiculous things. And it was in jail that his reputation was secured. He got, you know, credibility for having gone to jail for his right-wing beliefs. And while he was there, he wrote his memoir, Mein Kampf, My Struggle, in which he essentially laid out his political program. It's a rambling, frequently incoherent document that lists all of his anti-Semitic complaints and his, you know, ambitions for Germany and so on. And essentially, this gave him, when he was released from prison, a lot more popularity. He used these thugs that were organized in the so-called brown shirts, the Sturmabteilung, to intimidate much of the population in the various elections that were held in the 1920s and 1930s, but he never gained a majority of the vote with his Nazi party. Here you can see the elections of 1928, he only got 2.6 6% of the popular vote. He got actually quite a bit more in 1930 and 1932. His primary opponents were really the Communist Party. In March 1933, he garnered 33%. With a lot of dirty tricks, but ultimately, when you look at the comparison with the other parties, you can see the Communists lost quite a bit in that last election. The Social Democratic Party, the second largest, only had 20% of the vote. So in the coalition-style government that was prominent in many European countries at the time, Hitler was given the opportunity as the leader of the largest single party, the plurality, to form a government. And that's when he was able to come to power. He proceeded early on to identify Jews with the so-called Nuremberg Law that clearly identified them by racial characteristics, that is, how much blood was in them as measured by their grandparents, creating a very racist society that was dependent for all kinds of advancement in various careers and in public services like education and so on whether or not one was free of any taint of Jewish blood. Jews were removed from civil service, from the courts, from education, and a whole series of measures were put in place to gradually push them out of German society. This culminated in a dramatic attack, the largest attack of its kind, called Kristallnacht, in 1938, it was really a nationwide pogrom against Jews, a widespread attack, widespread burning of synagogues. The name itself, Kristallnacht, comes from the broken glass that littered the streets of German cities. And it was kind of like the last warning for the Jews of Germany that they had better get out. The difficulty was that although many Jews were really quite willing to leave Germany, and a large number of them did, there are very few countries who would actually accept them at that time, as immigration quotas were imposed and fewer Jews were able to find safe haven elsewhere. We're going to continue with the onset of World War II and the Holocaust in the next lecture. Thank you very much for watching.